Good morning. Welcome. We're glad that you have joined us this morning for Junior Church. We are celebrating Palm Sunday today, and we're so glad for our risen Savior and how Christ has risen from the dead for us. We are going to start by singing, I am a CH. I need you to help me sing, I am a CH. How are you?
I am a C. I am a CH. I am a CHRISTIAN. And I am CHRIST in my HEART, and I will LIVEETERNALON. I am a C. I am a CH. I am a CHRISTIAN. And I am CHRIST in my HEART, and I will LIVEETERNALON. I am a C. I am a CH. I am a CHRISTIAN.
Impossible.
Good job. Okay, it's time for our prayer time.
Number six.
And we are going to pray and ask the Lord.
No, no, no.
Number six, what we need. Okay, little technical difficulties. We're going to have our prayer time. We're going to ask the Lord to be with us and to help us. Easter's almost here, and we want to thank the Lord for what that He has done for us.
No. Okay. Number six is ready.
Okay.
Just like our person. Turn it down.
Turn it down.
There you
go. Let's fold our hands and close our eyes. Lord, we thank you for the Easter season. We thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice you made for each one of us. It doesn't matter if we're an adult or a child. It doesn't matter who we are, Lord. You have died for us. And you came to life to give us salvation so that we can be home in heaven with you for eternity. Be with each child, with each person who's listening. You see the problems that we all face. Lord, I don't know what the problems are, but Lord, you do. For the scripture says you see the sparrow that falls. You know each one of us, for you have made us. And Lord, we ask that you would be with each situation. For those who are listening, help them, Lord, right now to tell you their problems, for you care and you love each one of us. Be with us today. Bless us during this Easter time and help us, Lord, to love you and to put our hope and our trust in you for our future. And for all that you do for us, we thank you. Amen. Okay, let's sing one more, Casting Every Care Upon Jesus, number seven. Okay, number seven. Turn it up a little bit.
Casting every care upon Jesus, for he careth for
a very good song to remember. Give your burdens and your cares to Jesus. He cares about each one. Tell him about him. He wants to know how you are doing. We're going to finish our Easter story this morning, and I have Josh to help me today. Okay, number 11. We were talking last week about the disciples, how they had fallen asleep in the garden, and what happened with that. After a while, Jesus went to Peter and John and James. Had they too been praying? No, they were tired and they had fallen asleep. Just hold it still. They had fallen asleep. Jesus called, "Peter, are you sleeping? Could you not watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not enter into temptation." But the disciples were too tired to keep their eyes open. So Jesus left them. And again he prayed, "Oh, my Father, if this cup cannot pass away unless I drink it, your will be done." How bitter was the cup of suffering for the sin of the world. No, move on. Jesus returned to the disciples, but again, they were still asleep. So he went back and he prayed the prayer for the third time. Jesus knew the time had come when he was to drink the cup of the wrath of God against sin for the world. The world's sins, not his. And Jesus was ready to pay the supreme sacrifice for sin. To the sleeping disciples, he said, "Sleep on, take your rest. The time to pray and watch with me is past." Through the darkness, the disciples saw rushing people coming at them with lanterns and torches and swords and clubs. And Judas, the Iscariot, one of Jesus' disciples, was leading the group. He had brought the enemies of Christ, soldiers and officers from the chief priests, scribes, and Pharisees. Jesus, though he knew what they wanted, asked, "For whom are you looking?" "We're looking for Jesus of Nazareth," they shouted. "I am he," Jesus said. His enemies were so shocked at his answer that they stepped backward, falling at his feet. And again Jesus asked, "For whom are you looking?" And once more they answered, "For Jesus of Nazareth." Number 12. Find number 12. "I told you, I am he," Jesus said. "So since I am the one you want, let my disciples go their way." He was concerned for his disciples, and he did not want them to be harmed. "Hail, teacher," Judas called out. And then he kissed Jesus on the cheek. It was as if Judas had said to the enemies, "I was with him tonight in his inner circle. He will not resist. See, he let me kiss him." So the soldiers seized Jesus and tied his hands, making him a prisoner. And turning to the chief priests and captains of the temple, Jesus asked, "Have you come with clubs and with swords to take me as a robber? I sat with you daily in the temple, and you did not arrest me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness. All this has come to pass that the scriptures of the prophecy might be fulfilled." And we want number 13. "And God the Father spoke from heaven to his Son, saying, I have already had glory, and I shall have glory again. And the Lord Jesus had honored his Father God on his during his life on earth. And God said he would again have honor. This time he would receive glory and honor through the death of his Son. To those who were confused by the voice from heaven, Jesus exclaimed, When I am lifted up, or am on the cross, I shall draw everyone unto me. He was going to die for the sins of everyone, everywhere. Yet 700 years before, the Isaiah the prophet had written that their eyes would be blind and their hearts hardened so they would not understand. And though he did many miracles before them, yet they believed not on him. So Isaiah's prophecy was fulfilled." Number 14, Joshua. "Later that week, our Lord ate the Passover feast with his disciples. The Passover was a reminder of something which had already happened, but it was also a picture of something which was going to happen. Almost 1,500 years before Jesus, the Lord Jesus, lived, the Jewish people were slaves in Egypt. And to get them out of the hands of the slave owners and back to their homeland, God had to punish the Egyptians. And the most severe punishment was the death of the firstborn children, a punishment the Egyptians could not escape. However, God promised the Jews that they could escape if each family would do one thing: kill a lamb and put the blood on the top and the sides of the doors. And I will pass through the land of Egypt, God said, and I will kill all the firstborn of the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And the blood shall be to you for a sign over the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And it was so. The Egyptians lost all their oldest children and animals, but not one of the Jews were killed. So they would always remember that God told them to make a feast. They were to roast and eat the lamb which had died in the place of the firstborn. And year after year, they were to observe that special day. It was the Lord's Passover. At each Passover, they were to explain to their children what God had done for them. So for hundreds of years, the Jewish people ate the Passover once each year. And the Lord Jesus observed the Passover with his disciples the night before his death. But the Passover took on new meaning that night, and it was to be replaced with a new observation. Number 15. Today, when Christian believers meet together and take part of the Lord's Supper, they remember him, the Lamb of God, who took upon himself the sin of the world. Almost nothing is easier than eating broken bread and drinking juice from a cup. It is a simple exercise, and believing is also a simple exercise, simple enough even for a child. To become a child of God, one must believe. Believe that the Lord Jesus is the Son of God, that he died in place of each sinner. Believe he wants to forgive one who trusts him and receives him, and to repent from our sins and to tell God that we are sorry for what we have done and turn away from our sins. Number 16. And what is the central, most important truth of the Bible? It is this. God the Father sent God the Son for the specific purpose of being the Savior of the world. He gave his life for a ransom for you, for your sin, for my sin. But he did not stay dead. He arose and he lives. And he waits now, this moment, to live in your heart. Have you asked Jesus to forgive you for your sins? Have you accepted the gift that God has given you? I hope that you have. And if you haven't, you can. Tell the Lord right there, wherever you are, that you are sorry for your sins. Ask him to forgive you and to come into your heart. Believe him that he will, and God will save you from your sins. And I hope during this Easter season that you have, if you haven't already, you will ask God into your heart. We're going to sing Christ the Lord. He is Lord, and God is Lord of all. Sing it with me. That you have come and you have joined us. May you have a wonderful Easter season, and may the Lord dwell in your hearts and bring you closer to him during this special time of the year. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.